I've been tying up some loose ends the last few weeks on our Centroid Acorn retrofit of the DynaMyte 2800 milling machine. Last time around, I got the automatic lubrication system plumbed back up, so I decided it was time to take a few moments and get the pump wired into the system. The original wiring in this machine was all shielded, so I like to cover the cut ends with heat shrink tubing to make for a neater job. I'm just going to wire this into a pair of terminals that are fed from the main incoming power. I've also started using a lot more ferrules in my wiring lately. By crimping these on, I can assure myself that when I insert the wire into a terminal block, there won't be any stray whiskers that might cause shorts. I will share a link to these crimpers as well as some of the other tools and materials I used in this project down in the video description. The motor in this pump turns incredibly slow and was designed to just run whenever the mill has power. There are provisions in the Acorn for running a lubrication system, but I figured the original design had it running continuously, so why change it? I next turn my attention to the on-screen interface. On the right-hand side of the screen is what Centroid refers to as the Virtual Control Panel. This interface resembles the physical control panels on systems like the Centroid M400 retrofit package. With the latest updates to CNC 12, it's now possible to customize the layout of the Virtual Control Panel. The panel's arranged in a grid of 6 columns and 10 rows. There are a number of files that determine the layout of the buttons, the graphic to display on the button, and the function of the button. You can also change the colors of the virtual LEDs on the keys, draw outlines to group like functions together, and add images like the Acorn logo. You can even have graphics span multiple rows and columns. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about how to do this. Mostly it's just a matter of editing the file to choose the row and column for each graphical element. Centroid has produced a pretty good video on the subject. I just wanted to give you a glimpse of what was possible. If you have any questions about how to work with this or you'd like to see a more in-depth video, just let me know down in the comments. While I was working on rearranging the buttons on the virtual control panel for the Centroid interface, one of the buttons that stood out to me was the one for the work light, and it occurred to me that that would be a pretty easy upgrade that I could make. So I hopped on Amazon looking for LED ring lights. What I was hoping for was something that I could fit around the spindle that would shine down on the work surface. And what I came up with was something from the automotive aftermarket segment. It's a product that's either known as halos or angel eyes. They're rings of lights that are designed to go around automotive headlights. Now, these lights are available in different colors. Primarily, of course, I'm interested in just a white light, and they operate on 12 to 24 volts, which is perfect for an industrial application. The dimensions on Amazon were a little bit sketchy. I couldn't quite tell from the drawings exactly what part of the light they were measuring, so I ended up ordering a few different sizes to see what would work out best. In the end, the size that worked out perfectly for me is what they refer to as 100 millimeter light. So the next step was taking a few measurements of the mill and then hopping into Fusion 360 to design some sort of ring that would hold this LED. I was looking to design a ring that would be a snug fit on the spindle nose, hold it in place, but I also wanted some shielding around the edges so that it would prevent the light from just coming out and blinding you. So I've got my completed light over here at the machine, and it's time to get it installed now. As far as installation goes, this is just like a snug, tight fit here on the nose of the spindle. I'll probably end up putting some double-sided tape or something in there just to hold it. But the next thing I need to do is get power to it. Now, the machine originally had a digital readout here. It was a tachometer to tell you what the spindle speed was. And there's a small cavity behind here.
This board originally ran on 5 volts DC, and it is a standalone board. It doesn't require any input from the previous control that ran the machine. So this could still function if you would get 5 volts DC over to it. It has a pickup on one of the pulleys down here, and it just directly reads the spindle speed. Not currently hooked up because I don't currently have a source of 5 volts in the machine. What I'm thinking about doing, though, is taking the wire, since it's already snaked all the way through the machine, and use it to bring 24 volts over to this cavity, which I can then use to hook up my LED lights. And then in the future, if I ever do decide to hook up this display, all I'm going to need to do is put a small 5-volt switching regulator somewhere in the cavity to break down the 24 volts into 5 volts to give me something to run that from. So I'm going to get this off of here, see what it's going to take to get the wire snuck up into here, and see if we can't get that to work. Just take this cover off and see what we have in here. All right, so I think we can come right in there. Well, I'm gonna have to splice this, put this up in here. Otherwise, I think that'll work though. I'm sure this is a little converter in here. All right, I think in the interest of getting this installed, I'm going to remove this board for now. We'll see about getting this threaded up in here. See if the heat shrink fits. Yeah, that's good. Okay. We've got red and green and white and black together. We're going to take the red and black for this circuit. So I need this red wire here, this black wire here. Heat shrink that stuff to the side for now. All we have to work with are these four wires. This will be our incoming 24 volt power from the cabinet. And this is our little voltage regulator we had. The final step of this process is to open up the Acorn configuration wizard and head to the output definition section. From here, I can drag the work light label over to the output number 1 slot. then write the settings to the CNC control configuration, and then restart CNC 12 for the changes to be applied. Once we're back up and running, the button on the virtual control panel should now control the work light. So one of the problems I struggled with quite a bit during this whole retrofit process was swapping out the original brushless DC motor for the DMM servo motor, and specifically getting the motor tuned properly. After quite a bit of work, I'm really happy with the performance, with one small exception. If I ran the motor at full tilt, like anything above 3000 RPM up to 5000 RPM, and I would either issue a stop command from the interface or issue an M5 through G code, during the deceleration process, the drive would always fault out. And no matter what I did to the tuning, I couldn't fix this problem. Some of the very smart folks over at the Centroid CNC forum, they suspected that the problem might be that the DMM drive, the DYN4, was not happy having the motor-enabled signal removed before the motor actually got all the way to zero. So Mark from CNC Services Northwest, he wrote a small code change for the PLC that inserted a 2-second time delay in there, gave the motor time to slow down before removing that motor enable signal. And that works perfectly. I can hit this thing up to 5,000 RPM. I can hit the stop button. It decelerates, no problems whatsoever. The only problem that causes mucking with the PLC code directly is anytime you go in and want to use the Centroid wizard to make some changes, you lose any of those manual changes you put into the PLC code. And that's what's happened to me. When I added the work light, and I used the wizard to select the output that I wanted to use, when the wizard compiled the code and dumped it into the PLC, I lost that change. So now I have to go back in manually and add those changes again. All right, so I'm going to shut down the software here. And I need to go into the CNCM directory. What we're looking for here is the Acorn Mill PLC source. Going to open that up. I am going to save this as PLC underscore Pete. All right, and now we're going to look for standard spindle. And again, and one more time. Okay. This is the part of the code that we need to change right here. And this little snippet of code is what we want to put in. So I am just going to copy this and replace all of this. Now I've got a timer in here that I need to actually find a home for, this VFD disable timer. So we're going to go up to the timers, search for timer. Getting closer, timer definitions. So we need to find an unused timer definition. So looks like 32 isn't used. Gonna go in here, just say is T33, and I'm gonna hit save. And then we're gonna go out to a command prompt. And we're gonna go to CNCM. And we're going to do the MPUCOMP, and the name of our file is Acorn underscore mill underscore PLC underscore Pete, and we're going to compile that to MPU.PLC and see what happens. I missed the source. Compilation successful. So there we go. There's all that. And then we have to power cycle the Acorn board. All right, so the Acorn has been power cycled. Now it's time to try to start the spindle here. And we're gonna run the speed up. This is currently in high speed, so if we run it up the whole way at the spindle, we should have 10,000 RPM. And then we wanna stop it and see if we get a fault. Okay, it stopped, no fault, and we'll go back to 100% and hit start, and we're starting. So that has eliminated that problem. Well, I'm pretty excited about the future of this machine now that we've tracked down the source of that spindle motor error. And I'm even more excited about a package I just received, but we'll have to wait till next time to get to that. In the meantime, if you'd like to catch another great project, click that link to the left, and I will catch you over there.